Hello everyone. Today we are talking to one of the PMP aspirant, and he has some queries and interaction and curiosity related to the exam and how should he go forward with it. So let's see what you want to discuss today. Yeah, give a little background about you and then we get started with your queries related to the PMP exam.
Yeah, actually, okay, myself, I'm basically civil engineer. Mm-hmm. And I am almost 18 years in Gulf working and you know in two multinational companies, and it's almost 12 years for me into the project management. Mm-hmm. And where I am directly involved into the core project management activities, when I read through this PMP guidelines, always I link to what I am doing in and around, but most of the times it is a little bit different, and it's a bit challenging to implement the process amid a lot of resistance within, and you know, to mm-hmm. educate the people around to benefit of PMP. But anyway, I am more convinced that, you know, following PMP process will always benefit the company. Mm-hmm. And in so many ways, you know, this is what I strongly believe. Because there are many people say, what is PMP and like why you want to do PMP and all. But I always justify for what I am doing is very much required. Okay, getting certification is very important, and also getting knowledge and transferring to the people and implementing into the daily life even without having the certificate, what I believe. So definitely I need to have a certificate, no doubt mm-hmm. about it. So mm-hmm. then coming to the point of these challenges, what I faced 12 years into the project management, and when I appear to the exam, and yes, with a preparation and studied some materials, so maybe I can disclose what I studied. And I just went through this PM PMBOK and the RITA. Normally, I just went through. And definitely, I followed some of the, rather than books, I get more picturized explanation given by you, Mr. Saket. That is more benefit to me because it will give a real life examples, you know, which will be more easy for me to imagine and use. So, this is my background actually, mm-hmm. and okay. I just appeared in March. It's because of COVID, it is postponed, and again it went to April. Again, it is pushed, and finally, I end up in taking in June 15th examination. Mm-hmm. So, I was a bit confident, and maybe I will just express what I think on PMP, what I read and what I face in the exams. Mm-hmm. Because whatever I read in the book is okay, it is just like some terminologies and which I may have to know. Otherwise, for me, what I need to know to pass the exam is how much it's like a general knowledge for me. I feel, maybe I don't know whether I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. I should be aware of the subject, which I was confident. When I appeared on June 15th, I was a bit convinced, and I was a bit upset. And also one of the, maybe the reason is I was wearing the mask. I don't know whether it is a reason. I was not able to breathe properly, no oxygen to the brain. I don't know whether I could read the questions properly or not. But irrespective of that, yeah. So I just now, after this exam, I definitely wanted to reach to you and ask, like, okay, it's one is preparation through the book's perspective and preparations to the simulator's perspective, mm-hmm. and preparation to, is there anything? I feel that definitely I'm missing something.
Perfect. We will explore. So what I'm getting is that you have been working in project management related activities for more than 11 years around, and you have a good understanding of how these things are done, and you also also realize that many of the things which you are doing may not be aligned or may not be as prescribed as PMBOK, because in reality you end up doing multiple different way of things and you end up skipping some processes but have some additional processes, and that's the reality which you end up working in. So that is again perfect, because nobody can tell you how exactly you should do project management. The PMBOK talks about general cases where in general in industry these things have worked and helped organization in doing projects, but again there could be a specific cases. Now with all that preparation, you read the books and all, you went for an exam and you feel that there is something missing, you get the terminology but still you could not clear the exam, so you are wanted to explore what is probably missing here. So based on your experience, because since you have given the exam, what do you feel like?
Actually, what I felt is I was very much aware on what type of question comes. Like, you know, question means the percentage share between the five process. And I was aware, okay, there will be, sometimes there is a confusion whenever it comes to the execution and monitoring and control, because sometimes there are some questions which we have to carefully analyze where otherwise initiating and planning, we can, according to my knowledge, we can easily pick, because the nature of question, because it and even the selection of answers, and it's easy to pick. Where I felt a little bit more challenging is execution and monitoring control, where it can lead me to pick the wrong answer. Maybe it will confuse. So this is where even when I checked my report card, where it is mentioning below target for the execution, and even I was surprised it is need improvement, you know, which is not very convincing for me. And the other two is target, actually it is okay, but I just get other three is completely out, the last three process. So this is what I felt is execution and monitoring control, where I feel it will be more confusing kind of questions. They are situational question, actually most of them are situational question. They will put us one scenario and ask what could have been done.
Okay.
What as a manager you should do. So this is where I feel that I need to, maybe work, I pick the correct answer, not the best answer. You know, that may be my,
Perfect. So what I'm getting is that in initiating, closing and planning, you were doing good, and you were not doing good in monitoring monitoring and control and executing.
Execution, correct.
Yeah. Execution. Okay, so these are that's a good, in a way, it's a good thing that at least three processes are good. And what I'm hearing here is that monitoring and control and execution is confusing, because when you read the question, you can't relate to which process group it is in. And if you don't relate, you may end up choosing some executional focused answer when the monitoring and control was needed, and you end up picking monitoring and control related question option when the execution was needed.
True.
Great. So I think you have enough insights, and your situation is not that complicated. So there is a known problem, and again the environment might have also played a role, else you could have just passed, because the three processes doing good is good enough. Now the question arises here is, how do we improve in monitoring and controlling and executing stages? Executing processes. Okay. Now my idea here is, executing is quite focused on the resource related stuff, the people related stuff, conflict management, working with people, and going along. And I do acknowledge that there could be a confusion when you are going along, you are monitoring them or you are supporting the execution. So I find majorly when people are, now we can understand your role more, but in general, where people are more involved in planning and monitoring, they may miss getting the signal of executing, because in your day-to-day job you might be more focused on planning and doing variance related analysis as it gets done, rather than focusing on getting things done with the people.
Okay
great. So this is like we know where the problem is, and in general what we need to start thinking in a way is that how do you work with people? How do you motivate them? How to resolve conflicts? How to support overall execution of work? And how to do a quality related work when you are really working on the thing? So this all part is executing stage. In general, what I usually find is it's easier to identify monitoring and control than directly identifying executing, because in monitoring and control, usually you have some clue of variance. If you are not getting any clue of variance, then there is a high probability it's an executing thing. So for example, you had three activities to do, and the question is asking that these three activities are going on, but you got a trouble in executing one activity. So you needed one particular resource, one particular hardware, and that hardware is missing. And you are, so what should you do in that particular stage? Now, this is that you had a set of activity, you had a plan, and you are working on the plan and you get blocked. Now, this is an executing problem. This is not a monitoring and control problem, because you are working on it and you, while working, you realize that my team need a machine which is not available to them.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is how we need to see that, okay, they are working on it. Now, the same question if comes in a way that they end up not getting the desired resources for their activity. And at the end, they have a variance that they end up missing their target. And you are looking at what can be done next so that they don't miss their targets. Then there is a delay. There is a delay between that activity happening, and it becomes a monitoring and control things. Because, you know, there was a plan. They were working on the plan. While working, they didn't come to you. You were not involved in solving their problem. But it has passed through. And now we have a deviation from what we have planned. And now it looks like a monitoring and control issue, you know. So there is a variance problem. Yeah.
Okay.
So this is something like monitoring and control related stuff. Good amount of monitoring and control, I would say good amount of monitoring and control is associated with change management. So the way change request gets operated, if you understand that part, you get a significant push in your monitoring and control related questions. So what do you think about that?
Actually, and when it comes to the change management, as you very rightly picked one, this question might be appeared in most of the 10 to 12 questions, actually, in my PMP, if I recall. Many times it will ask, there are some changes happened, and, you know, the sponsor will ask you to change immediately, and what as a project manager will do. But I always used to think, okay, first of all, I have to analyze what is the impact, and then process to the change request, actually, officially. So this kind of questions appeared, also answers also appeared in many, many areas. Mm-hmm. And I got a little bit stuck in this part, especially. Always I used to think, yes, processing a change request is the correct answer, actually, because I cannot, first of all, I have to make sure first internal assessment I have to do whenever there is some changes comes. I have to see, is there any impact? I also allow my team to work out. And then I will, if I'm convinced, I will go for the change request process, you know.
Perfect.
The control board.
Perfect.
For example. So this kind of questions arise and answer also arise. And I was picking always these kind of scenarios.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
then I'm not sure whether I picked the right one or not.
Great. So there are two things which you can do. One is that you can practice more and more change related questions, because that's a monitoring and control focus. And as far as your process understanding, I find it quite okay. I just wanted to introduce this, and I keep saying it's like a three A's, you know. First you acknowledge, then you analyze, and then you act.
Yes.
So we just need to see the situation. If we have a situation and there is an option where acknowledgement is not yet done, so someone is asking that, can you change it? Then I acknowledge that. Yes, I acknowledge that you have a need for change. That is my first thing. You know, I don't say that I will do an analysis or thing. I acknowledge it. Yes, you are saying something. I will acknowledge it. Once the acknowledgement is done, then I will do analysis of it. How it impacts internally. Is it really part of our scope? It could be clearly out of scope, which is mentioned in our project charter. I don't get there.
Yeah.
So I do an analysis, and based on my analysis, then I put the options in people's place. If I need to take a approval, or if it is a clearly which is an irrelevant thing, I act on it. So that's like the three-step process in general works. So we are not sure that how well it was working for you, provided those options were given to you. But that's the one area which I would say that you need to practice more and make sure that at least in a monitoring and control, the change related issues are over. So even you say that roughly you can say around 60 questions comes from monitoring and control, say around roughly. Yeah. So 50 to 70 questions, you can say that 50 to 70 questions comes in a monitoring and control. Now 10, 15 would be more towards change.
Yeah.
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 And once this change is done, then you need to focus on more on the analysis of data, like some way of interpretation of earned value, some way of interpretation of so that the data and then you create a performance report. So work performance data, work performance information, and work performance report. So that kind of stuff. So that where do you check that? So many times the integrated reporting and individual process reporting, that's the another thing which comes into the picture in monitoring and control.
Okay.
So you are need to focus on, for example, that where do you do a cost related things? So you do a control cost where variance get analyzed, but ultimately you have an integrated performance report where all the processes, performances get integrated and you show them to them to management. So that's another section. If you explore that, you should do good in your monitoring and control space. Yeah. Anything which is coming from your experience or if which is striking you that, okay, this is something I want to discuss in monitoring and control.
Actually, this is what I was just, I feel that I was, maybe, I don't know, it's a weakness. I'm not reading the questions properly, or is maybe also important for me to read the question twice. Because for me, I felt that the time was really perfect, because 240 minutes. And without even, I could see that 1 minute per question, actually, the way it goes, because last, when you are ending two words, it will become like a 100 minutes, 100 questions, you know, it will become that equation. Mm-hmm. It is like playing a one-day match, you know, it's like one ball, one run, you know, it's like that. So then it maybe leads to the little bit tension, because some questions are laborious. And maybe I also feel maybe I need to do more and more simulations to get myself to familiar, to make a time management, or maybe the 4 hours, you know, the sitting and taking the exam, because maybe it's a, this is what I just wanted to know, in what angle I have to focus, because since I was taken this exam first time, and that I really feel that maybe it's a bit demotivating. I will not take it in that way. Mm-hmm. And definitely the first way it is fail it, okay, at least I know where is my weakness so that I can focus, I think, in the positive part of that. But in that way, and also the input and outputs, okay, when we see this ITTO, and this time I didn't see much questions linked to that, because I spent a lot of time on this ITTO, because which is a little bit laborious, and I will not memorize, at least I will try to see the logic and what is input and what is the output only. I'm focusing.
Perfect. I think great insights. So let's see these two insights one by one. One insight is that you realize that the time starts running out, and you also realize that there's some level of tiredness starts coming in.
Yeah, I think it was a pause. There was a pause. Sorry.
Okay, there was a pause in between. So I think great insights. These are the two things which we want to explore. The first one is that you realize that there is a time pressure which comes towards the end. So that's the one thing. And you may also feel stressed after a while. So that's something is coming in the picture. And the second is that how to deal with the input output, and you realize that you didn't get that kind of a straightforward question, and how should I operate in the second step. Let's take them one by one. See, the time will, so in general, I advise people to do at least 4 full length tests before they go for a real exam, because you start making familiarity with a lengthy sitting for 4 hours and taking questions, because else you, if your mind is not trained for that, so after 2 hours, you may start feeling tired and you may just want to get out of it. You know, you just want to run, that it's over. It's been a while. I just want to finish it. So the internal body starts telling you that. So it's a great idea to take at least 4 to 5 full length tests in a one sitting, not in a part sitting, so that whenever
Okay.
you are going for an exam, you know how does it feel after 2 hours, you know how does it feel after 3 hours, and your body is ready for it because you have been there, rather than first time you are going through a 4 hour sitting. So that's like a kind of a must thing I advise to all the test takers. So I usually use
Okay.
a formula of 4 hours test, since that you take at least four, but you can take more, but at least four. Yeah, four tests you need
Okay.
to take just to train your body, not only about the questions and all. The second
Okay.
thing which can improve your reading speed is familiarity with more and more terminologies. And that you can do by the PMBOK lexicon or glossary, which you find at the end of PMBOK, and you can also download it
Yes.
from PMI. So if you
Hello.
make yourself more and more familiar with that, the what is a term and what is its definition, then your reading speed will increase, because sometimes the definition might be appearing rather than a term, you quickly know what they are talking about. And sometimes the term
Okay.
comes in and you quickly know what they really mean about it. Because in the
Okay.
absence of those vocabulary of PMBOK, it will consume more time.
Okay.
So these are the
This fair
two,
enough, yeah.
yeah, these are the two things you can do to improve your speed. Yeah. So that's
Okay. Okay.
the practice more and more practice test, and also familiarize with the terms more and more. The second thing,
Yeah.
which is input output. See, you may not get direct question related to input output, but you do see a what next will happen. And I can say that, and that could be a confusion between execution and monitoring and control also, because when you are in the executing process, what next, not necessarily always monitoring and control, you know, you may want to support the guy. Yeah. So we
Yes,
need
yes.
to understand the processes and their sequence, rather than just focusing on what are the key inputs and outputs. Any monitoring and control by default inputs are that, okay, you have a project management plan as an input, you have execution information in the form of work performance data or something like that as an input, and based on what is happening in the execution and what was planned, I need to do an analysis and find out what to do. So that's in general, all monitoring and control will talk about that section. There will be a few additional things, and each monitoring and control will ultimately may request a trigger for a change request, or may update the project management plan directly, or may issue some issue log or something like this. So in general, all monitoring and control will be around there. So start seeing that sequence that, okay, where am I and where should I go next? Especially for monitoring and control, since you find it little risky, gradually when you are taking practice test, as soon as you see the question, start thinking of which process this question is talking about. So if you map the
Okay.
question with the process, then you can use its
Okay.
input outputs and tools and technique to answer it.
Okay. Okay.
So PMI
Okay.
in the PMP exam will not talk about directly tools and techniques and inputs and output, but they are coming indirectly in the question. But the key is, can we map the question to a right process? Yeah. And once we map that, then we can find out very well. In order to map those processes to a right process to question, you need to be very familiar with the process definition. You know, you should know all the process definition very, very clearly in a multiple languages, means the way PMBOK defines it, the way you understand it, you have your simplified version of each process that, okay, these processes are meant for this. And each process, the key input and key output should be in your head, not necessarily memorizing input outputs, but this process exists for this thing. Once you do that,
Okay.
I think you are good.
Okay. So that means there is a, it's exactly like a flow because first time when I see this input output, I was seeing a bit, actually maybe it's my mistake. I don't know. There is one last minute I get into this master prep actually. One, I get into that. And when we look into that and the PMBOK, because this master prep, what he says is he will look the process wise. So for example, he will go vertical, you know, he will talk about vertical, you know, in some are it take you to the horizontal, because for me, I was more familiar with the horizontal, like initiating, it will take you through the, what will happen after initiating, planning and execution, monitoring and closing. So it is more clear for me that in initiating, these are all the 5 knowledge areas. So that means maybe I confuse. I don't know whether it is right to do so many books or I should stick to only particular. I don't know. Maybe it's like it's a 2 different methodologies.
Yeah.
Maybe.
So see, in general, like once you really get everything, then you in a way, each book talks about the same content, but in a different language. So technically, it's like same flavor, you know, all the ideas are expected to be the same. But yeah, they use different way interpretation. And so I would say books are not a problem, but sometimes exam preparation tips and tricks could be a problem. So maybe, and especially now, because now you have seen the real exam. So you don't have to go with anyone's tips and tricks because you know what is going to happen. But just to understand different way, the PMBOK, I think it's okay. Whichever style works for you, you can pick it up because ultimately the content is same. The PMBOK also talks about same content. Rita also talks about same content. Everybody has to talk about the same content technically, yeah, because that's the common thing, but they represent it differently. So I think you should not get confused that much now, especially because you have the history of looking at it. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I felt like a PMBOK is more dry, you know, it's like a dry Rita is more, it's like a, like it's more interactive and that would be more easy with the term. It's like a, we are speaking, like reading a story kind. And PMBOK, and even I felt after this exam, just want to share with you, I might not have given more focus on this grocery last part, you know, maybe because I feel that more of the terminologies from the PMBOK will be visible in the PMP exams rather than Rita. Rita is just for understanding and PMBOK is maybe for terminologies. That's what I felt after taking this exam, because Rita will not tell the terminologies. And PMBOK will give you the exact catch points, like because which is missing in Rita. Maybe this is what my observation actually.
So, perfect. So, I think now don't worry about the content study because you have it. Just make sure that how quickly you can capture it now. And in my advice, you should focus more on practice tests now. Maybe pick up 2-3 variety of practice tests. Focus more on practice tests, and you may find a lot of wrong practiced questions also, but you should be able to detect them that, okay, I am not in agreement with this question. So try to start finding that. And we do have a forum, forum.eisenbridge.com, where people keep coming and discussing their questions coming from practice test. So whenever you get any practice test question from any source, there is a high probability if that's a controversial question, we might have already discussed on our forum. So you can check that, search it at forum.eisenbridge.com. You may find the answer directly. If not, you can post that question and participate in understanding why it is right and why it is wrong. And that will help you.
It's a debate. It's like a debate we are talking about. We are brainstorming the...
I think that part will help you the most. And when you take a practice test, you don't have to just be happy with, I have marked the right answer or I have not marked the right answer. You need to focus on, once the practice is over, you need to be very clear why particular option was not chosen. You know, why you are not choosing something and why you are choosing something. Because see, these practice tests are not meant for just giving you a number. They are meant for make you ready. And if you do this part, and even if some practice test has a wrong answer, but if you know exactly why your answer is right and why somebody else's answer is wrong, you will do great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, that's a good point. I think then coming to this simulation is like, okay, because I was also a bit confused. It's like a big question. So because this is where I just wanted to take advice, like simulate. There are so many, but just to pick the right one, because yes, there is some good and also the, which is the best one to that we have to
so it's very subjective. It's like, it's very subjective, and I don't have any recommendation here. And I do see one of the possible thing you can do is you can keep reading people who have done the recent exams and see what they are talking about it. But again, I see the preference also varies a lot, and everybody has their own style of looking at things. Some and see, the idea is I'm a test taker and I pick up one simulator, and I have not seen the other three. And if I find satisfied with this, I pass the exam. Then I don't care what is there everywhere else. And I will only talk about the one which I work with. So it's very difficult to find out which one will work. My recommendation is maybe you start with the one you already have and make sure that you understand why the questions were right and why the questions were wrong. And if you find more and more frequently the answers are wrong, and the answers are, because now you have seen the exam also, you can compare. what kind of a lengthy question, what kind of a tricky questions were there. And once you see that, then you can decide if you want to try something more or beyond that.
That's good. That means it is not, this is a good point what you said. There is no barrier of having one or two more simulators, and irrespective of this was my confusion for picking one simulator. Then I thought if I pick this and I will pick the other one, maybe I will be confused. So because when they explain you the right answer and the wrong answer explanation, so it will be in the PMI terminology. I hope so.
That's so, it. So that's you need to focus on your explanation, and that is the problem. Yeah. You know, each exam creator is giving their interpretation. It's not the final interpretation, and it may not match with the PMI interpretation. And there is a high probability you will find at least 10-20% questions, similar kind of question in two simulators, but the answers are different. You know, answers are different. So what we need to do is, as a test taker, I need to have my own judgment, and I say that this is why I believe this is right. Yeah. And that is the key. Once you start, don't go with the test taker's test creator's answer. You know, test creator saying this is a right logic does not necessarily serve your purpose. So you have a PMBOK content, you have generic understanding of project management, and you have a question. You take that question as a source, and then you answer it. Now, it's you are answering it to practice your skill, not to check is it a right or wrong. And when you see that your opinion is not matching with the test creator opinion, then you need to know what is the real reason. So you can put into a discussion forums, you can discuss with people and see either you correct your own thinking or you ignore that question. Says, okay, looks like this question is not matching with overall, and I move forward.
No, that is a good point. I think I have to focus in that way because there was a confusion, which I think it's clear after talking to you. I think that's the area which I have to focus now more. And I think now, yes, you're right. I will not spend too much time on the books and more on the simulators and real-time exams where I should focus, I think, which is one which is missed. And also this COVID, anyway, this is one. Wearing the mask also, I don't know how much percentage it contributed to. And it was no oxygen to brain, so it was making me a little bit nervous. Sure. So that is, and I hope that is one thing I do. And now I think they are making also one option of work testing from home.
Yes.
I don't know it was how far it is suitable because I don't know. I just have to figure out myself because next time it's depending on sometimes if it's stuck, the internet speed and other things.
Yeah, so that's a risk you need to take care. But in general, it's working. And another thing is don't forget to keep practicing at least four sessions full length. You know, usually the people who have like long professional experience, that is also one of the critical thing, you know. So you don't have a habit of sitting for so long and thinking like a student because the real problems are very different. And when you are answering the PMBOK question, you don't question the situation itself. You just take the question as if that is the only question you know. And you only take information which are given in the questions. So that's another big problem which happens, especially when people have experience. They add lots of information, you know. So whenever you see a question, you add a lot of assumptions into it. You know, it might be happening there, it might be happening there, and then you answer it. So by doing a practice test, you need to develop a habit of first sitting for 4 hours and also focusing on question as a question and not adding anything extra. Not adding anything extra and taking your judgment about the answer based on what is written in the question. That's it. And I think that is the main skill which you need to practice and start focusing on executing and monitoring and control. Start detecting the process, that as soon as you see the question, you detect the process and say, okay, this is how it is working. And now this is the option I have to choose. I think with that, you should do good.
Yeah. I think this is a very valuable, there are four or five areas which I could now feel that, yes, I had a lapse and gaps, I would say, and I have to focus. I think now maybe this will be really a good talk, and this will, because I keep seeing, as I told you, and yes, I will again, I don't mind going through all of your videos, and which will definitely ease my time up, you know, after I see, listen to your video, and if I read that data, it will be much easier for me.
Perfect. Because
this is what I really, it's a great.
And I feel that you are quite ready, because see, there is a clearly thing, because in a day-to-day work also, you are more involved in planning and monitoring. You are more involved in initiating and closing. So planning, initiating, closing is already good. You in monitoring, since you were more involved, so that might have spoiled the executing part. And that is the whole thing. Correct. There was a confusion in between and change management part. So we have a decent thing. In general, like a case like you, like people don't take more than a month, you know, they just pick it up, they fix those things and just pass through it. Yeah. So it's a good a situation, not that bad. Yeah, should do good.
Yeah, yeah, really. Thanks a lot, Mr. Saket. I think it's really a very appreciating session, because I just wanted to, this is what I thought, not to delaying, you know, this is just 5 days after my test. I just wanted to connect immediately, because I did them. Many people do the mistake by giving a long gap. Yeah. And maybe that will also one of the things. Again, you will forget the things what you read already.
Sure.
I hope I will definitely work on it.
Yeah.
I will be in touch with this Eisenberg interactive session. If anything is there, I will be part of that also. And then it will be a great. Yeah. And
thank
also
you.
Just to compliment that, you know, your videos and whatever, no, it is helping a lot. It's like, you know, the household name, you know, your name now has become like very famous.
Thank you.
You are doing a great service, really. No words for that.
Thank you. Thank you for your words. And definitely, if you have any follow-up questions, if you need anything interaction like this, or if you have some set of questions to be addressed, we can arrange similar interaction again. And I really liked your idea of not delaying it, because at least three process groups are very clear and in your mind. So just for two process groups, not to delay and go ahead and prepare and fix it. Good.
Yeah.
Thank you. Nice Thanks talking a
lot.
To you.
Thanks a lot. And nice meeting you, and stay safe. And best regards. Thank you very
much.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Nice evening. Bye-bye. Bye.